seconded, the agenda is approved.
I think we need to vote on it.
Oh, sorry, I just agreed. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed?
Jennifer Sisney is absent, right?
No.
So tired.
Okay. So now, we're going to recess to close session. Okay, so we're reconvening to open session. Can I do the flag salute, please?
Please stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So then, to report on the closed session, the issues that were discussed were threats and the public employment discipline, etc. All of that was taken care of. The informational part is the fun part. Or, I'm sorry, there was no action taken. Took action. Okay. Either way, we're going, Superintendent Beecher.
What did I do?
Well, I responded for you incorrectly, but I was corrected, so now we're fine. Student of the month at Brookside Elementary School, please.
We have students of the month here?
We do.
Oh. I thought we were just happy to be here.
Yeah, those are. And we'll do everything to keep them coming.
I'm Kathy Crossman, and I'm the principal at Brookside. And so many of us teachers are here today because we're honoring some very special students. Our students that we have selected to be recognized at tonight's meeting, they exemplify our goals at Brookside of being safe, respectful, responsible, and kind. And they have outstanding attendance, and they have great academics, which go hand in hand, and my guess is that they have really supportive families, and I want to thank all of you for being here and for supporting your children, and all the teachers for supporting your students, and thank our board for also supporting all of us so we can do our job. So I'm going to call them up. Up, and I would really love it if we could just make a long line. There are nine because we were told we could choose one from each grade, but then in TK we have three classes and we just couldn't leave one out. So we have three from TK. So we have nine. And we're going to, hopefully we'll have each student with the teacher and the parent. And we'll just make a big long line, and then we'll do certificates, and I'd love it if you would help me pass out certificates.
Sure.
And then maybe we can get a picture out for the newspaper. All right. I'll do it from here.
I'm a superintendent, everybody, so I'm happy.
Oh, yes.
Happy you are here. Thank you. Congratulations to all of you.
This is Mr. Beebe.
Let's get fired up a little bit. Let's go. Come on, man. Let's go.
Starting with Aubrey Adam from the She's such a collaborator. She's a gift to us all every day. And she makes inclusion come alive at Brookside, which we're really, really proud of. So thank you to both of you. I can't tell you how happy I am.
that they are framing and building workstations for next trimester's electrical and plumbing classes. They just met with Toyota Material Handling Facility to secure forklifts for students to learn on and hopefully build a relationship of resources and networking for the upcoming heavy equipment course that's going on there. And deep in the design and preparation for the new set design course that will be supporting the drama production in the early spring. Building the entire set for a little shop of horrors. So they're very busy in the CTU program at our high school. At BGMS, departments have started using their time for backwards mapping, CFAs, data collection, and standards planning. I think Aurora's involved in that a little bit. Each department has agreed upon when they are using the time. Leadership is planning the Spirit Week and Halloween Dance for October, as well as a Turn BGMS Pink Day on the 18th. The web program is teaching SEL to sixth graders bi-weekly. This week they will be hosting a social on Friday. Yearbooks are for sale, pre-sale this time, at a little bit of a discount. And volleyball has had a busy season, and they are currently raising money for gear through the Servathon. At Blosser School, conferences are in full swing. Third grade's going on a field trip to Ukiah Pumpkin Patch next week. Maintenance was out earlier this week fixing sidewalks that were falling apart and dangerous. Blosser educators also want to appreciate our awesome custodial staff, who are always thorough and hardworking. And there will be a thriller performance on October 31st at 10:35 a.m. Thank you to Kathy Tilton for that. Fourth grade is also going to the Exploratorium in early November. At Brookside, parent-teacher conferences are happening at Brookside with the goal of meeting the parent and guardian of every student at the school. They're going to have a Halloween parade and class parties with food once again allowed. They also have Blue Zone Self-Care Day which was a Friday early release day where they were able to see cooking demo, dance, and get a 10-minute massage. Really? Congratulations to the Brookside Students of the Month that were honored by the way. So in further great news for the board, I don't know if anyone has had a chance to review the unaudited actuals. The estimated total excess funds as reported to the board on June 26th was $982,709, as shown in the multi-year projections. Today, we see the actual excess turned out to be a whopping 270% higher than the original estimate. Part of the explanation for this large variance is the, quote, mid-year change in staffing in the fiscal office. And I think this is a nice, polite way of saying that we inherited a big pile of doo-doo. That's okay, but in any case, it's these hidden funds from budget gimmicks that always seem to appear year to year when the district reveals their hand at poker come on an unaudited actuals time. Another part of the explanation is that unfilled positions save on expenses, but the local indicator report last June indicated that there were only 4 unfilled certificated positions. I'm not sure how many classified positions were left vacant, but I can't seem to square away how this only accounts how this is the only reason for a magical $1,666,000 that somehow couldn't be anticipated back in June. Regardless of all this, when the board members hear of deficit spending tonight that is ongoing and continuing in the revised budget, which in the accounting world is technically accurate, that there will be no deficit to the district coffers. In fact, the accounts are going to be $1,278,000 richer, even when accounting for the $389,000 projected deficit this year in deficit spending, that we're going to be $1.2 million richer than board members were told last June. So, I also want to make a quick suggestion for the upcoming FIT and school accountability report cards as admin and maintenance do their walkthroughs. Perhaps it would be good to take along some other certificated members experienced in construction and maintenance and do a secondary walkthrough to make sure they're not missing anything. At the very least, this can save us from hiring a third party for $46,000 to report the same things that we already know. That was under Joe Aldridge for a walkthrough that we did. I'd like to end by saying thank you to all the administrators. I've been in contact this past month with the administrators from all the big sites. There are problems, but we found resolution and found solutions. So they've been very communicative with me, and hearing it all. And I think, I didn't write this part down, it's not a manuscript, but I feel a sense of stability and communication improvement, and the system seems to be working better now. And I have Mr. Beebe to thank for that, so thank you very much. That concludes my statements.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Beebe, our superintendent.
Thank you. Thank you, Brandon. It is a pleasure to work with both of our bargaining units, by the way, and our unions, and resolving issues as they come up. We have 240 some odd employees, and things happen on a daily basis. And I, although we hope that nothing happens during the day, things happen. And how we kind of get from point A to point B and then back to point A acceptable fashion is important to me. I also appreciate the fact that our administrators are communicating easily and well to come to solutions as well. And that's a big compliment to them as well, the ones that are here. So we're in our eighth week. We're no longer kind of in the beginning of the year. We're past the beginning, and now we're kind of approaching the middle, and we're about a month away from the holiday season. As all veteran educators know, October is a difficult month. It seems to go on and on and on until you get to November. I don't know what it is about October. March is somewhat similar also. We're kind of flowing along, and I'm seeing a lot of wonderful things on sites. Every day I walk out of my out of the district office, and I see the kids playing over at Blosser on the playground. They're screaming and yelling and having fun and running around. And it looks like chaos, but there's a purpose to it. So I see that on almost all of our sites. There's a lot of smiles these days on sites. There's a lot of, I don't have any real data to show you, but it just feels like there's a positive vibe on most of the campuses that I'm on. I want to talk a little bit, Kathy was just here. They were...
She's just right outside.
Maybe I won't steal their thunder, but I actually won't. Blue Zones did something kind of wonderful at Brookside. I'll let her come and talk about that. I thought homecoming was very well organized and spirit-filled. I thought that the people that were in charge, administrators, DADs, this bracket, for certain students, created a very nice and pleasant homecoming environment. It's always nice when you win the homecoming game. The night before, the performance was really solid and tight and on point, and the staff did a great one, and all the students did good stuff. So, Brandon talked a little bit about the construction. I want to remind the board that we applied for a strong workforce grant last year, and Shane and previously Mr. Kovig applied for this grant, and we got, how much is it? Half a million?
Like 520 or something like that. Okay. I don't know the exact number.
So, and then we're parlaying that into developing a forklift academy.
Yeah, so the intent is we are getting some simulator equipment and simulators. They're the same simulators they use in the training programs for heavy equipment. So the kids will be able to, in fact, we actually had an organization come last year and give us a tour for the kids on the actual equipment they use to train. So we're getting the same ones, and then we're also going to have forklifts. We're looking at purchasing about four forklifts so that the students can walk out with a certificate, forklift certification, and go get a job. And they should hopefully have some experience on the simulators that they may be able to jump into trade school of some sort, or at least walk into a job with some experience. Through that, we're working on a potential partnership with Toyota, the largest distributors of forklifts, and that's an opportunity to potentially have, because they have a mechanics in the area for forklifts, potentially have them come in and actually do some sessions with our students and see where it expands. Right now, we're just in the exploring phase right now, so we haven't necessarily gotten down that road, but we're hoping in potentially as early as 4 to 5 weeks having those pieces of equipment on site.
And this is part of a long-range plan of applying for a couple of other strong workforce grants. One will be coming up this year, I think.
Agri-science,
and then potentially culinary. So these are plans that we have. In various stages as we kind of go through these,
and all of them will have a certificate all in us. And so we're very comfortable with hoping that we're going to get these things kind of off the ground and rolling. And that also dovetails into the work that Aurora is doing over dual enrollment and connecting our dual enrollment with the college and taking some of our existing CTE pathways and creating dual enrollment pathways with the college. So we got a lot going on multiple levels, and so excited stuff. A lot of balls in the air. Other than that, it's all good. It's good to see everybody. Kathy, I was going to talk about Blue Zones, but then I saw you outside, and I'll let her talk about, not right now, during public comment. How's that? We're doing the information.
Just reports. Did you want us to take a second? I trust you've shown up to do an award, right?
Well, I'd be happy to hear from Kathy.
Yes.
Rather than have her stick around and be part
of
that.
No, please don't talk about the Blue Zones.
Isn't that your little channel?
Yes, do you want me to also recognize Shania?
Yes.
Okay, come on up, Shania and Grandma. Grandma, stick around for public comments, too.
Oh, good, well, we'll have those in
the This is Shania. She's in Mrs. Cooley's class. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, come on up. She is so safe and so respectful and responsible and kind. She is all of those. Plus, she has great attendance. She comes to school all the time. And she knows her reading. She's just learning to read. So we're very, and doing her math. We're very proud of her. And so she got an award because she's an amazing student.
Yay.
We can talk about Blue Zones in public comment, or you can talk briefly about it now, but let's try not to steal it from your green public comment. But if you want to talk about Blue Zones.
Are you talking about Blue Zones?
I was going to talk bigger than and.
Okay.
Brookside and.
Do you just
want
to talk about Blue Zones in a public comment then, and I'll just pass?
Mm-hmm. Or you can talk about your experience.
Okay. So, all right. Blue Zones. We were, you brought up Blue Zones and we were asked to investigate. And we investigated, and boy howdy, we already were doing many of the things that Blue Zones stands for. So it was pretty easy for us to be recognized as a Blue Zone school, which we just found out this week. And it's quite the honor. And and they said that we were the first ones in what, the county?
Yes.
Yeah. That's what they were talking when our Brandon was talking about the staff day. It was really our hour and a half little thing at the end of the day, but it was about Blue Zones and about supporting yourself and you know, putting your own.
Oxygen mask.
Yes, mask on before you can help the others. So, anyway, thank you so much, and I don't want to steal your thunder.
Do you want to be thunderous in about 5 minutes?
Yes.
Sue, Mr. Boltz, do you have anything you'd like to say?
Obviously, congratulations to all the students of the month, as well as the staff that was recognized tonight. That was pretty awesome. Boils down to is all of us really appreciate the work you do more than you realize, and it's just anytime we can get an opportunity to pat you on the back, we can try to do so, and it's very much deserved. And I would argue the same thing is true of many of our administrators, and I'm looking at one that I'm very proud of as well. So, Kathy. with respect to what we've been going on, Mark and I have been spending some time walking the sites, looking at ways we might be able to improve security, also looking at Brookside in terms of how we're going to deal with expanding or improving our facilities for TK. A lot of stuff revolves around how we're going to use bond funds. Also been looking at the HVAC system there at Losser, trying to make sure that we're making the right decisions with that. Other than that, that's pretty much all I've been up to.
Thank you. Jennifer Sippy.
Hi. Again, thank you and congratulations to all the kids that got awards today. This morning I went down to Ukiah to the college and sat in on a program talking about the Indian Child Welfare Act, which when I was a social worker with Child Protective Services, it's one of the things that we functioned under. And it was put into effect originally because so many children were taken from their families and separated from their community and their practices, their cultural practices. And so this was an attempt by the government to help get them really adapted to living with their tribes and with their customs. And the title of it was Children Are Medicine. Our children are medicine. They're healing. And it shed light also, besides the effects that it has with CPS, we have kids that are in our classrooms that we don't know what they've gone through, what their life's been like, what traumas, what joys. And understanding more about the tribes and the histories just benefits people that are working with children in their neighborhood. And so that was one thing I did today. And yeah, that's about it. I'm really glad to be here. I love this place.
Thank you. Jean Kim.
I'm excited to see all the staff here and the parents that came and the students. It's a real pleasure to see everybody at the board meeting. And I just wanted to appreciate Mark for all that he does. Every time I've had a question, every time I've had requested a meeting, every time that I don't understand something or I want further confirmation, Mark makes himself available. And he's a real stellar administrator, and I just really want to appreciate him. I had some questions about the agenda, some on the warrant registers, expenditures, and some other questions. And he spent almost an hour with me explaining things and connecting things, and that's just the way Mark operates, and I appreciate it. And I've had the great experience this past month, visiting a couple of the TK programs and spending about an hour in each in two of the TK programs and getting to know the program more fully. And I tell you, those TK staff members work really, really, really hard. The multitasking that requires to look after all those four-year-olds, it's a lot of work. So I appreciate the opportunity of having that opportunity to observe. And I have an appointment set up for, I think it's this at the end of this month, to observe all day long among the TK classes, so I have a better idea of the full day program. And I was asked by the administrator, by Maggie at Blosser, if I would attend the site council meetings as a grandmother, not as a board member, but as a grandmother. And so I attended my first site council meeting, and I really appreciate all the work on behalf of the staff is making on behalf of Blosser in my experience at that site council, but I know that each school has a site council and that there's a mixture of staff members and community members and parents who are working hard to make sure that the instruction at each site is effective. And when I was at the site council meeting, I was one of the staff members at Gloucester let me know that there was a problem with one of the walkways that was dangerous. And so I took a picture of it and I sent it to Maggie, and she sent it to maintenance. And 2 days later, when I was back at Gloucester to volunteer in a fourth grade class, maintenance was already there fixing the walkway. And I was just amazed because I've heard that sometimes it takes a while to get requests for maintenance filled, but they were Johnny on the fixing that broken sidewalk. So I just wanted to commend maintenance for that. And again, I'm volunteering in my granddaughter's fourth grade class, and It gives me, I've sort of done that with each of my grandkids through Glosser, volunteered in their class, and it gives me an understanding at each grade level as to the instruction that takes place, all the different things that go. Anyway, so right now I'm in fourth grade, and I'm helping with math instruction in the morning twice a week. And then on yesterday, I think it was, I was asked, because my son and my daughter-in-law have a meeting with my granddaughter's teacher. I was asked to pick up my granddaughter, and I was supposed to meet her at the flagpole, so I got there a little bit early so I could get a parking space. And there was a special ed staff that was sitting on the benches waiting to get picked up or waiting for their buses, and so there was like four staff members and, I don't know, five or six or seven students. I'm a special ed teacher in my heart, and I just saw so much love, so much kindness, so much care. This is at the end of the day when people are really tired, staff members are really tired, and I saw so much just wonderful things going on between those staff members and those kids. I was just really blown away. And those kids are getting some wonderful care there. And I know that's true in all the special ed classes. And then another time, I can't remember what morning it was, when I was at Blosser going into the fourth grade class, I saw a group of boys hanging outside one of the bathrooms after school had started, after school had started, so this is in the morning. And I saw Val,
Custodian,
thank you, at Blosser, the daytime custodian at Blosser. And he was sort of waiting around the side of the building, and I sort of moved over to talk to the boys, and he says, "That's why I'm here." And he was waiting for those boys to find out why they weren't in class and why they were hanging out in the bathroom. So it's just an example of the many hats that staff members wear at a school system. I mean, Val's not just a custodian, he's also somebody that keeps his eye on kids, and that's just an example of how different staff members wear different hats. And I just want to commend Brookside on being a Blue Zone school. And I think that's really exciting. I was really excited to see Blue Zone's presentation to the board last year. And I don't practice Blue Zone specifically because I didn't know about Blue Zones before I took on my lifestyle changes. But I'm going to be 77 next week, and I have excellent health because I basically put the Blue Zone principles and ideals to work in my life. And it really does work. So. Anyway, that's all for me. Thanks.
Thank you, Diane. Okay. High school, you did well at your homecoming. That was really nice. I attended Bechtel Grove girls volleyball, and it was nice to see all the parents from River Oak coming up for the sixth grade, seventh grade, and eighth grade girls team. And that was really nice. I think you were there too. That was it. And then I went up to Sherwood School to present a lesson on tangrams in Annapurna's classroom. And it was really nice to be back in the classroom for a while. That was really nice. So that's what I went to. Mine was short.
All right, thank you. And as for me, I did, for the first time in a long while, go to a high school homecoming rally, which not something you usually do, but it was truly entertaining. So as long as I stayed, it was great. I knew about Mr. Bowles's acting skills and about Miss Bakewell's. But the rest really surprised me. They did real, real well. So that was entertaining. And as far as the homecoming game, I'm not really sorry, but I'm sorry that football is not one of my most favorite things to watch. However, it was good that our district, our high school, won. Yay for them. And I watched about 4 minutes of a basketball game. before I decided I had chores. So that, you know, that was really entertaining. So I did see the condition of the floor, and it will be really nice as things improve there. I'm really happy with your report on finances. I truly appreciated the way Melissa did the, there's an opening page for people who don't know it, on what was, what is, and the difference. Really, really nice. That is the fastest little way of looking at the budget I've ever noticed in this district. I've looked at this district's budget for almost all the years I worked here. And I also, you know, I did have a couple questions that we'll discuss in a little bit, but I was especially pleased that even though the rest of the budget all looks like it always looks, it it had a little more precise numbers, and so that was a real good thing for me to notice. Other than that, I do whatever I always do, and there's no sense saying it over and over again because most people have already said it. So you're in luck. I'll stop. I just have one sentence after I stop, and you get your thunder. And so I'm done. Thank you very much. My sentence is our student board member couldn't be here, and so now it's your thunder. Or, I'm sorry, let me straighten this out. Any comments from the
Yes.
Good.
Before
and please,
before Tina speaks, I need to apologize to her.
All right.
You know, I'm sorry we didn't tell you where the new board meeting location was.
I should have looked.
I'm so sorry. Okay, I just saw your text. So I did say I'm sorry, but way late. So, sorry.
Yes.
My apologies.
No problem. We figured it out. thank you, Google.
Yeah.
And I just want to say this is not my thunder.
I believe
this
you.
Is really about honoring the work of this school district. And I want to say first, I'm the proud grandmother of Shania. She is a TK student at Brookside. She did not start school this year at Brookside. And let me tell you the difference in the school environment and climate here at Brookside Elementary. My granddaughters, Shania and her older sister, who's in first grade, are so very happy. And my daughter has just noticed the warm, welcome environment that she goes into at that school. And I just, you know, good job. So it's no surprise to me that Brookside will be our first school in Mendocino County to achieve Blue Zones recognition. And what that means is that, as you know, Brookside is committed to creating a school environment that fosters the physical, social, emotional, as well as the intellectual health of the students. And that rolls out to the community. And as far as, you know, what Brookside has done, that extends out to the staff. Dr. Crossman and our team member Ryan really organized an employee wellness day to really honor and give back to those employees that give every day to our young people to grow up to be healthy, happy, thriving members of our community. And under Dr. Crossman's leadership, it looks like we may be adding Sherwood to the list very soon. As well as Sanhedrin, I had a meeting with Aurora here earlier, and we took a look through our list of best practices. And again, Sanhedrin is doing already all of these things, so it's a matter of time before that recognition goes to Sanhedrin. And I would like to extend that out to every school in our district and really show that recognition. I want to just lastly say through the month of September, Ryan, along with Christy Wisdom and our public health partners, CalFresh Healthy Living, they did a series of taste tests throughout the schools for the students. And I hear that was very, very popular. And we're also active members on the Health Advisory Committee as well. So I just thank you for your support, and I thank Willits Schools. My children went through your school system, and now my grandchildren are here. And again, Brookside is where I started my career back in 1994,
as a substitute. So just a lot of love for this community and this district. Thank you.
Thank you.
Here we go. Can we give us a brief overview of what Blue Zones is?
So Blue Zones is a community-led health and well-being initiative. And so the original, it's based on the National Geographic studies where they went out to these communities, these pockets of communities around the world, where people were living well into their hundreds, and living well into their hundreds. And so they wanted to know why. So they did a pretty long-term study on these communities and identified these nine commonalities. And then now the Blue Zones projects that we're rolling out through our communities here, we're one of, I think, 78 or more now in the United States implementing those findings from those communities into our local communities ourselves. So we focus on policy, people, and places. So places, work sites, schools, that's where many people spend a lot of their time. So if we have healthy environments in these places where people spend the majority of their time, then they're more likely to be healthy adults, right?
Where's Blue Zone funded? How is it funded?
Our local project is sponsored by Adventist Health. They're not our employer, but they are the sponsor. So our local hospital system has what they call a community benefit requirement, and that's how they chose to fund or chose to do their community benefit, was to invest in this project in our local community. And we're countywide and a small team of five, so we have big ambitions.
I see you're looking for a coordinator.
Yes, we are looking for a coordinator to work with our places sector.
My people want jobs. We're good.
I know. I wasn't going to promote it here. I'm not trying to steal anyone. Just say it.
She's got a raise.
Yes, so we are down one staff member now, so we're at four. But in the interim, I will be covering for any work that needs to happen as the executive director. You know, that's my role. I want this work to continue. And I expect we'll fill that position quickly because people know who we are now and they see the value in what we bring to the community. So I think that'll be a short-term vacancy.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? All right. Thank you so much.
Okay, come ahead.
I'll be real fast.
No, take your time.
So Brandon and I got to go to a meeting last week with the CTA leaders from Mendocino County. And so there were a few things discussed that I just wanted to kind of share with you guys really quick. One of them was is that CTA is really promoting going after those community school grants. I don't know if we're doing that, if that's something you want to do, but you might really want to think about that. Lake County has been awarded really huge grants. And it does involve the community as stakeholders as you make those plans to spend those funds. And have you seen those commercials on TV? Where they're like doing food pantries, or there's dentistry available to students on campus, or you know, different medical needs, things like that. So it's kind of a neat way to kind of support our community better. Anyway, so something for you to look at.
It's a lot broader than that, but yeah.
Yeah. So I just wanted to just kind of throw that at you. Lake County got awarded them, so if you're interested, please apply for that. I was sitting there talking with the Ukiah president of the union president, and she's a TOSA. She's the student success coordinator at one of the elementary schools. And I was also talking to the district board member for CTA who came to visit us. And so I was kind of doing a little whining about our CASP testing because I feel terrible for students who can't read but are really good at math, and they're taking these CASP tests and they're not doing well on the math because they can't read it. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And so it doesn't seem fair that you're being tested on reading as well as the math at the same time, right? And so I was telling him, the district board member, because I'm like, please go back and fight for this because every kid should have audio turned on. Well, the gal from Ukiah, she says they turn it on in Ukiah for the lowest 40% of readers, and they call it a designated support. And it's at the teacher's discretion to allow the math task to be read on the math test. And for students who speak a different language, it can be turned on in their language. So I really hope this is something that we will move forward with, and I think we'll see a big boost in our math scores for those children who really can do math, but just struggle with reading all of that detail. Anyways, that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Don.
Okay, thank you, Don.
Anyone else have anything they would like to contribute?
I missed one kind of crucial piece that I wanted to surface publicly is our enrollment's at 1542.
Good.
Which is roughly equal to what we were last year about the same time. Plus or minus about 5 or 10 kids.
Okay, that's good.
With respect to the CASP testing, you mentioned audio being turned off. I know that they do this online, right?
It's digital, yes.
So normally the audio is turned off, obviously, because if I'm sitting next to you and so on and so forth.
Well, they all have headphones.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then that clears it up.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
But only the children, so what we've been doing is that the children with 504 plans that allow it to be read, or IEPs, have it turned on for them, but there's so many more students that really need that support.
Is there a rule that says we shouldn't or can't?
I think we assumed that. I don't know, but after talking to her, she's like, well, we turn it on, and they've decided that at a district level that, you know, it's 40% of their lowest readers.
So I would be happy to look into this teaching facility so we don't.
Yeah.
It just seems like a no-brainer. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
If we could direct you to do that.
So absolutely. I would be happy to dig in more with what Don said.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So now we're at the consent agenda, and just before we carry on about that, there have been a number of questions about the warrants. Are we all satisfied that we don't need any more questions on the pull that? You're okay, or would you still have something to discuss?
Well, at some point I'd like a specific accounting of what, for example, goes on the Airmark. I just don't understand how you spend $5,000 a month on Airmark.
Yeah.
I have multiple phone calls. Are you going to pull that and discuss it, or do you want to discuss this one?
No, I don't need to pull it. I'd
be happy to talk to you privately about my phone calls that you have. I just didn't mention it. You know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'd like to know the response.
It's not just that. I mean,
no, there's a couple others that I've missed.
It's just there's
monthly service. We have a couple months of service that a deeper oversight is going to occur.
I worked for a fire district where the fire chief reviewed every single invoice, every single warrant. And I could tell you a couple stories about it, but the nice thing is this guy had it. He had it, his thumb on it. I have no idea how much time he spent at it, but we're a $25 million a year budget for a fire district. The little stuff did not get past this guy. And I'm not suggesting that we have that problem, but I'd sure like to have, I'd like to have the confidence that we don't.
Thank you. Just for anyone who might not know, the determination 30-day review is the same thing we do every single month. Is there anybody that, I mean, do you want to know what that is? Or
you need to get a first and second.
Before I can discuss this,
yes.
Huh?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll second.
Thank you. So it's moved and seconded. All of those in favor say aye.
Aye. If you want to discuss anything, don't go after a vote.
Oh, I don't want to vote. Oh, I mean my rules. Okay.
So,
sorry.
Yeah.
And I just went to a Brown Act bill to do everything right, right?
Okay. We're all a work in progress.
Yes, there you go.
everybody is.
Some progress a little slower than
it's all right.
Okay, well, so since that's the case, we really didn't vote. If you don't know about the determination 30-day review, you need to sort of shrug your shoulders or whatever, and we can explain it to you. Otherwise, it's the same thing every month. We sign it every month and say that if, isn't this the Zoom one? Maybe, I don't know what it is. Oh, okay, that we can still get information. The other on the obsolete books, those are the same ones we did last time, and these are the first readings for board policy revisions. Mostly, they only deal with new words. Sometimes there's a whole new policy, and so next month will be the important time, or sometime during this month, because if you want to make a change or you want to ask about something to make a change, that's when you need to do it. This is just introducing you to the fact that it exists. Okay, and y'all know what the quarterly uniform complaints are, right? Okay, then we're good. Do we now have any questions? No? We want to vote? Okay. All in favor of passing the consent agenda?
Aye.
Aye. And that takes care of that. Now it's the replacement of the Blossom Lane cafeteria HVAC system. Do you have anything you want to say before Marquez? Oh, okay. She might say
we're
she
talking
doesn't
about item C, Charlie.
Aren't I?
C.
Yeah. Isn't that?
Oh, you were asking about public comment then?
No, we're done with public comment.
Oh, sorry.
Comment.
My apologies. I was
talking. It's okay, you're a thing
Alex
of progress.
Yes. My fault. Yes. I would blame him, but it was my fault.
Okay, well, we're on C.
Okay, got it.
I only was asking Maggie for the principal Wasser if she had anything to start with, like a plea or something.
No.
Or if you just wanted to talk.
Oh, no, I bypassed, sorry, Principal
the
Grant.
I bypassed
Principal Grant completely. I sat in Blosser's cafeteria, multi-purpose room, cafeteria. It's a multi-purpose room, actually, but nonetheless, a Google cafeteria. There for about a dozen sessions last December and January, watching little young people play basketball, my joy and love and passion for life. And I can see my breath at 5 o'clock at night in this building. And I said, this is unacceptable. This is not going to happen. And then I began hearing some reports that there were various ways of heating the place. And I'm thinking, if it's cold at 5, then it's probably cold at noon. No more. We're going to fix it. Now we have this enormously large, huge tower that looks like some kind of sculpture right by the San Francisco Bay Area. They have a big arrow coming through it, and I don't know what that thing was for. So I told Terry, we're going to fix it. Figure out a way to find me somebody to fix this thing. New, I don't care what it is. And so this is what they call a high split unit. And there's also two or four enormous units inside of the cafeteria as well. Not just the one outside, but there's two really big units in there. And so we've done a pretty good job of doing something called splits all around the campus for other rooms, but this is going to be for the cafeteria so kids can eat and play a little basketball or do and have plays and all the things that Principal Duran wants to do with it being a decent temperature. So we did a public
that's the kids.
I don't know what it's called. What's it called? Public bid format? Public bid format for 30 days. We sent it out. People bidded. This is what we got. And this is where we're going to go. We only got one. Yes.
No, there's this fly going around.
Yes. They're mainly being me. I don't know what the deal is.
So to move this a little further along more correctly, I will make the motion to approve item C, replacement of the Blosser Lane cafeteria.
Okay. Any other public discussion?
And to add to the discussion, we will be using bond funds for this from the 2021 pool, because we have some residual bond funds that we are spending down before we do the 2024 beginning of that pool.
Good. Well, to add to the discussion, not only can it be cold, I generally avoid that except for Christmas programs or winter programs. In the summer, it's worse than awful, and you can't do an assembly or have a program get through the day, evening, or whatever without just feeling extremely uncomfortable. So it's really nice.
Brookside's next on my radar, but my third and fourth fifth graders are not going to even 32 degrees.
appreciate it when it's not 107 there.
Or, well, Professor, 107's fine.
Well, I know, but the rest of us are left there, so we don't. Okay, so the approval of the GAN Act is
next. You haven't voted.
Oh, we haven't. You know, I need a sign. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Good. It is moved and passed. Now, we're on the GAN limit.
Do you have a motion?
For the GAN limit before we can talk about it? That's right. May I have a motion for the GAN limit, letter D? No one.
No.
I move that we approve the GAN limit, resolution 2022-23.
Oh, thank you.
I seconded.
Any public discussion? How about private discussion? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 That was moved and passed. It always makes me uncomfortable the farther we get down this list, because it seems like the things that are really important to me are always near the bottom, and that's when everyone's halfway out the door. Okay, letter E.
I'll make a motion to approve unaudited actuals report for 2022-23.
My second. Okay, discussion.
Okay, if you're okay, are you guys okay with me presenting from here, or would you like me at the podium?
Whichever makes you comfortable.
I like the seat. So unaudited actuals, I don't bring multi-year projections, nor do I talk about deficit spending or any of that. Unaudited actuals is focused on our previous fiscal year, so at first interim, middle of December is when I'll bring multi-year projections with our revenues and our reserve limits and spendings.
Yeah.
I do want to say deficit spending, though, is just the term used for spending more than our revenue. It has nothing to do with our ending balances or our reserves. Unaudited actuals, as you can see, we have about $1.7 million more than we anticipated having had budget adoption. And the reason for this, that one, there will always be some variations because of how certain funds and resources are allowed to be budgeted. There are some funds that we aren't allowed to have an ending fund balance, so we have to book expenditures, and moving forward, those numbers are going to be a lot tighter. I can guarantee that. Part of it was salaries, simply because I came in at a time where typically these are cleaned up at first interim. It wasn't done at that point, it wasn't done at second interim, so I didn't feel comfortable removing some of those things from the budget simply because I would rather be on this end of things than move too much out of the budget and be in a worse state.
Well, I really thought that that was good. I think the board was of the impression that those changes had already been made in the salaries and the positions. We were assured things got cleaned up regularly. And I'm just really happy that that tightened up considerably. Like I told you before, I super appreciate how it is very clear here what was thought to be the cost, the budget, what it really turned out to be, and what was or wasn't left over. I had a couple of questions. Are you all done talking, by the way?
Okay.
All right. I had a couple of questions because one of them that says there is a huge discrepancy about what was thought to be bought and what was bought on the second cluster for other outgo. I mean, it's not so huge, but you could pay people to work here with that much money. But the flip side is sometimes when you think you're going to go buy something and you don't buy it, what you have that you're still using breaks, and in the middle of the next time, you need something. Capital outlay should be things, you know. And I'm just wondering if it's a matter of everything seemed to be working fine, or just a true use of the word estimate in case something might break and didn't, or
so
you might need a piece of a machine or whatever.
Other outgo includes our contributions to other funds, so if there was decreased expenditures and higher revenue in our cafeteria fund, so that decreased our anticipated contribution.
education also came in a little lower, as well as special ed. So where other ALGO comes in.
Oh, okay.
I guess special ed wouldn't be counted in there.
They're not really ALGO, but that's still the idea.
Still a contribution, yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And then over here, where at the very top, where it was other state revenue, who or what gave us extra money, like $1 million?
Some of it was, we received $300,000 for a cafeteria grant that was applied for through CDE. It's only for kitchen infrastructure. There was also the arts music instructional materials grant at $400,000 and UPK funds at $110,000.
Okay.
That weren't initially built into the budget at budget adoption for 2022-23.
Would the state then pull back some of those funds?
Not of those grants. So the arts music one had been, that revenue we received more than we, they are pulling back some. But that will happen in 23-24, and it didn't impact 22-23.
Okay, and with the cafeteria, I know we talked a little bit about that. Do you mind going over that again, just why we didn't end up spending? It seemed like nearly every year they were pulling an additional 60, 80, however many hundred thousands of dollars.
300?
Yeah, that was a disappointment. And so, all of a sudden, it didn't happen. And like I told Julia, yeah, it seems like their allotment got bigger. It doesn't need to happen. And you didn't really think that was entirely the case. So if you could sort of say that now.
I believe we're getting more revenue from state and federal sources now that we are required to serve two meals a day to every single student. So now we're feeding more kids, we're firing more planes, and receiving more revenue.
Okay, and there don't seem to be any recent concerns over all of our paperwork making it where it belongs in an appropriate amount of time?
As of right now, no.
Oh, that's really good.
Since I bridge both our current assistant director and our past assistant director, those concerns were brought to me when I first came here regarding food service and nutrition and cafeteria. And so there was an attention to collaborative discussions on an ongoing basis to ensure that those particular paperwork dynamics are taken care of on a consistent basis. And so we have meetings with all of our directors to ensure that we're on the same page and things are getting done a little bit more efficient.
Good. Well, then in addition to thanking you, I thank you very much. Because those are little things that just eat it.
Not that every single department is operating as efficiently as I would like, but with food service, we're doing better.
Yes. Well, are we the half full cup or whatever it is? Because that's good.
I do want to tell you, Melissa brought to me the dynamic of the difference of amounts. Kind of in July, she mentioned to me that she saw something that seemed a bit odd. What do you want to tell? Do you want to tell first interim? What do you want to do? And so she did find it kind of after the June meetings in July. So I think I probably should have brought it to you probably in August when we kind of found it. So I apologize for not being able to remember.
Well, I appreciate it a lot.
Because we want to be as transparent as possible.
No, and that's really good. Truthfully, in my mind, anyone who deals with any type of business, in particular
public funds especially.
Yes. Really needs to understand their budget, and when it's made as difficult as can be, you get it understood, but it is so time consuming. And certainly I don't pay attention to every single fund, which I'll work on one of these days, but I have two or three little pet ones, and I'm glad to see they're shaping up is all. It shouldn't be that hard to add and subtract and be done. Although certainly it requires expertise, you do a wonderful job. Next, no more conversation. You might have.
Can I ask
please
you two quick clarifying questions? So you don't bring the 23-24 budget to the unaudited actuals meeting. I see it in here within the official unaudited actuals forms and with changed numbers. So I just wanted to clarify what you meant by you don't bring it to.
So So an audited actuals is focusing on past, the past year. So up until, so I don't bring it. So that's the budget as of right now. So any expenditures and things like that that have pulled over into SACS, which is the accounting software we use as a state accounting software. Budget is technically then pulled in from escape, but it's not, this is not a budget reporting period for 23-24.
Right,
it's a budget reporting period for 22-23.
Okay. I just saw 23-24 budget here. I'm going, well,
yeah,
it did change those numbers.
Not
so P1
first interim. First
interim. That's what it is.
We are done with that October 31st. I have a month to complete it. It comes to the board December, the second meeting, the first meeting in December, the only meeting.
Got it. Okay. And then the other one we had to do with enrollment numbers being about the same time this year. However, I've noticed, and correct me if I'm wrong, that attendance is actually much higher. So what implications would that have for ADA? You're prepared to answer that.
I'm not prepared to answer exact numbers, but that will also come out at first interim once we have all the census data input. We are at higher enrollment than we anticipated at budget adoption, though. So
okay.
I will say that.
Do you want me
to explain to you what Brandon's asking? Did everybody, does the board know what Brandon's
asking? Sure. I'm comfortable with it, but so enrollment is up slightly.
Yes.
And we have attendance is also up across the board. You know, percentages are
yeah.
It's up. Brandon's asking, actually, it sounds like a rather simple question, but it's actually a little bit complex. So on Wednesday, last Wednesday was census day. That's when the state pulls your enrollment data.
What?
No. It's called census
data.
It's called census.
It's like CBAS.
So that's your number. That's your number for the following year. Not this year. It's for 24-25. Our number was pulled a year ago for this year on the exact same day. It's the same day every year. P1, P2, even P3, we take ADA percentages, which means that we'll make the math really simple. We'll say we got 1,500 students, okay? 90% attendance. So you take 10% away from 1,500, and they fund you on that number. So if it's 1,500, it's 10%. Somebody do the math for me.
1,350.
Thank you. 13. So we get funded at 1,350. That's why many times budget projections at a certain point are difficult, because last year we thought we were going to really be about 88-89%. And we actually were up a little bit. We actually got, I think, to 91.5, 92 percent ADA, which is nice. Now, historically in California, everybody used to be at 95%. Didn't matter where you were. Okay? I don't know how they did this, but everybody was 95%. But post a certain point, about 7 or 8 years ago, when they started doing ADA a little differently, everybody's scores and percentages began to adjust a little bit, certainly the LCAP area. So our percentages right now are up. So we're going to be hopeful that we don't get a bad month.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's all. That's what you're always hoping for. You don't want to get a bad month. It's like this or a bad month. Some of our schools, kids stay out a little bit longer than they normally would. Okay, so we see some interesting percentages at some schools. But on the whole, we're up. I mean, these are positive. These are really positive numbers. I mean, kids are coming to school, which is always a bonus. It's always a pleasure when they're coming to school more and more. Well, they're not staying out as long. It's 1 day rather than 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
So we're staying away from, we may find this when Aurora reports about chronic attendance and chronic short and absenteeism. So that's when the data will begin to pour in. So great question, Brent.
Thank you.
So that's kind of a relatively simple answer for a 9-month complexity about how schools are funded.
And so is that to say that the rule about the attendance for the current year or the year previously is no longer in effect? Where the state would look at you and say, well, you know, on this day, we decided you were going to be considered a 1,500 student attendance, but because in reality you ended up being a 16, then you get budgeted for the 16.
Well,
that change is made.
It's a, is it on YouTube tomorrow? So the system is a bit archaic because it can benefit you and hurt you. So let's just say you start off with 1,500 students on October 4th. and you have a great attendance rate, let's say you're at 98%. Well, what happens if you get 100 more kids that come into your system 8 months later? Well, you're going to get funded at 1,500 students, but you now have 1,600 students. Mm-hmm. So it actually hurts you if you get more kids to come in. Then you got to put in some waivers, you got to put in some requests to state. We got a bunch more kids in. Okay? Because, again, it's always a year before. It's not current. Okay, so in March, is it March when we get the final?
It's actually even older. So if you're lower this year than you were last year, it gives you an extra year of planning time to make the changes necessary to meet your funding. So say we're at 1,500 this year, we were at 1,600 last year, we can claim the 1,600 from last year, and that buys us a year. But they're also changing it to potentially look at a three-year rolling average. And that's, I haven't even really delved into that too highly.
The COVID era.
But you get the higher of whatever it is, as long as you qualify.
The COVID era. COVID era kind of messed us up a little bit because they did hold harmless for 3 years. So whatever your highest number was, that's what everybody says. You know, you were counting you know, everybody who was ever born in your system for a while there. You get as much money as possible. So, you know, good question.
Thanks.
You got a vote.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And opposed. Okay, passed. Here's my now we need to approve the Education Protection Act expenditure report for 22-23.
I'll make the motion to approve.
I'll second.
Okay. Any discussion?
This one's a rubber stamp we do each year.
Yeah. We have a few rubber stamps. All those in favor? Oh, well, then good. We'll take a vote. All those in favor, say
aye.
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 Okay, and opposed is in. Okay. So now, we need a list of things for next month's agenda.
Or not.
Or not. I'd like to know a little more about the custodial schedules, please.
I have that. Most of that information for you.
Oh, wow. Well, then. We don't need to put it on a public agenda?
I'm really close.
Well, there's only two people to really ask at this moment, but...
No, don't ask.
Okay, I won't. I won't.
Okay. Well, unless there's anything else, I'll make the motion to adjourn.
Second to
tell me. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Oh, come on. Someone needs to adjourn.